So good afternoon, everyone. I am Kalpana Kannan. I'm the project manager and also the program coordinator in the Department of Computer Science in IIT Bombay. So I welcome all of you to the live session. And today we will be taking the questions on computer science, programming basics, object-oriented programming, data structures, and algorithms. So first 1 hour, I think, will be devoted for programming basic questions. So if you have any questions, you can post it on chat, or you can also ask live questions. So both the options are open for you. And just before we open the session, I just want to tell you, if you have any issues regarding login, registration, or any other issues, please feel free to contact us. We have two email IDs. So one is eoutreach@cse.iitb.ac.in, and the other one is course support cse.iitb.ac.in. So both the email IDs are open, and you can post whatever difficulties you have. You can write to us. And if you are a first-time user, so I suggest that you go through the demo course, which is also available on IIT Bombay X. So that will give you a fair idea of how to navigate through the courses. So some of you may be new to online courses. So if you are new to online courses, so I suggest you register yourself for the IIT Bombay X demo course and go through it. It will hardly take not more than 2 hours of your time. So that is my recommendation. And apart from that, I think many of you want to know, these are the general queries which we often get. So I just want to answer those queries. So one of the query is like, when will you get the certificate? So the answer is, the certificates will be e-certificate. It will be an honor code e-certificate, and it will be given to you after the course ends. So it will be sometime around in November middle or November end. So you have to wait. Even if you have finished your course, you have to wait till November, because only then we can generate the e-certificate for all, for those who have qualified. So you have to get a passing grade to qualify for the certificate. So if you get a passing grade, you will get an e-certificate, and it will be on your dashboard, and you can download it and you can display it or print it, whatever you want to do with that. And secondly, many of you want to know whether this course will be available even after the course gets over. So the answer is yes. The course will be archived after the course gets over, and it will be available permanently on your dashboard. So you will have the access to the material even after the course gets over. Some of you want to know if you have joined late, whether you'll be able to complete. So all the courses which we have published on IIT Bombay X, they are all self-paced courses. That means all the material is available to you, and it depends on you, like how depending on your pace, you can finish the course. So even though the course may be of 4 weeks or 6 weeks, you may be able to finish it in a less number of weeks if you are good at it, or you can take a longer time. So it all depends on you. But the course will remain open till 15th of November. So, but you have to finish all the graded assignments and graded quizzes before the course ends. After that, it will not, you'll not be able to appear for the quizzes. So that is very important, that you finish all the quizzes before the course ends. Then you'll be able to qualify for the certificate. So with that, I now invite Firoza and Nagesh to take on the live session, and they will answer your queries. So as I told you, some people have already posted their questions through the Google form. So Nagesh and Firoza will take those questions first. And after that, they will make the floor open, and you can post the questions on the chat, or you can ask the questions live. So when you ask the questions live, I request all of you to unmute yourself so that you're audible. And also, if you because the whole session is getting recorded, so in case you want, you can also switch on your camera. So both the options are there. So you please unmute yourself when you ask and switch on your camera so that you are visible. And otherwise, you have to keep your mics muted so that it doesn't disturb because so many people are going to join. So you should mute your mic. Only when you want to ask any questions, you should unmute and ask. So with that, I welcome all of you again. And over to you, Firoza and Nagesh, for the session. So I hope you all will enjoy the session, and I look forward to your interaction. Thank you all.
Thank you so much. Yeah, so we'll go through the questions first that we have received for programming basics and object oriented. So Divesh Kumar Patro says that I am not able to complete the PPS 04. Is he present today? Okay, so these are practice questions, and you will have to work on it to complete it, because it won't be, it is not like you just write an answer to something, you know. So it's not like a fill in the blanks, or you know, so you'll have to work on the logic, right? So you know, and then use your pen, paper or something, come up with some logic, then I think you should be able to do that. But of course, all practice questions or anything related to, I mean, the doubts that you have. So discussion forum is the best thing, because there are people who can answer, right? So your own peers will be able to answer. There are TAs who will help you, right? So you'll have to take that decision. What is to be done? So another question is, how to utilize the course and how do we study? I mean, this is very generic question. So course has got videos, then you have even transcripts are there, so that you can see what exactly, I mean, if you are not understanding proper English, then probably transcripts will help you. Then you have exercises, right? So you will have to work on those exercises, and that is how I mean, you should keep on writing code. So you know you have to inculcate that, you know, kind of these are very important, because unless you write code, you will not be able to study. So this is more of a skilled, I would say. I mean, though generally we say the computer science is not a skilled course or general course, but I would consider it as a skilled course, because you need some skills, right? You need to understand. You need to understand all the different, the way the program is written. So what are the elements of the program? So that becomes very important. Right. Then we have CodePort does not execute the codes properly in graded assignment. Why does it happen? So now see, as a computer, even if you give an extra line or extra space somewhere, right? So the specifications are always given to you. So this is the input and this is the output. Now if your program is right? So if there is an extra space, extra some, you know, lines or some other character, right? So that will really not match with your code. So will there be Python language course after these courses? Yes, we can think of it. But why C++? Because so you see that there is another course which is object oriented. So before that we cover basics, right? Which is very important. So where you have, you know, you go to the machine level, right? I mean, I'm not exactly machine level, but very close to the machine kind of, you know, architecture. Now C, C++ courses are, the code, where codes are written. So you go to embedded systems, you know, where you'll have to write more C and C++. So to understand, I mean, so that is the base we are getting in programming the first course, and then you say, okay, now I understand these constructs, so looping, iterations and things like that. And now I say, now we say that, okay, so can you now play with objects, right? So when you play with objects, you understand what is object oriented. Then Python, if you consider any standard library, right? So in object oriented programming, we don't introduce standard library in the beginning, because to understand what is a vector, to understand what is a stack, right? So this has to be, you know, you have to work out the details. So there are ready-made libraries like STL, right? So which we introduce towards the end, right? So then you compare and see how are they. I mean, you can see a lot of abstraction in that. So when you go to Python, right? So you will not have something, you know, you will always have this abstraction. So even transition going from C, C++ to Python is easy. You have to understand only programming, right? So once you understand what is programming, you can do it in any other language. So, I mean, we may also think of coming up with a course, but not at present. How to improve iteration concepts and function-based concepts. Now, so what is an iteration? Right. So iteration is having some initialization, right? I mean, so you have to initialize. I mean, you start from somewhere. Then you have some condition check that you want to do. And then you have to iterate, right? You have to change, I mean, the initial condition which you have already set, you are now moving towards some, some final, where you put it in the check. You know, you have a check which says till it reaches at that point, okay, so I'm going to iterate. So that is what is iteration, right? And talking about function, so function is nothing but instead of writing your code, okay, your code becomes too big, right? So it becomes very difficult to, you know, understand. So not for you, or you may also find it difficult to understand after some period of time. So what you do is that you abstract it out, and then you say, okay, I'm putting some specific code in the function. Right, so function is not your main class, you know, main int main, that itself is a function, right? So from where the program starts, and then you include hundreds of other functions, it makes a call, you know. So it's a good practice to actually, you know, move some code out of your main, so that your main class, you know, a function becomes very small, right? So many softwares that you will notice that the main classes are very small, wherein very specific codes are written in functions. So you will have to understand what is a function in this sense. So how to match? So also it is hard to match the level of IITB. I don't understand. I don't think it is correct to say. Because, so though the courses are rigorous, but this rigor is important. I mean, if you this rigor, if you don't take it, you know, as a part of your life, then you know, there would be some you know, gaps in understanding or writing code. So these are very important, you know. And then you can transition anywhere. So I know people who just know C, C++, and that's it. And then if you tell them to give to write it in any other language, maybe Scilab or, you know, any other language in the world, so they will be able to write okay within 24 hours to 48 hours. So this rigor is important, and so that the fundamentals are strong, and then you inculcate those in your written programs. How many attempts are allowed in case you fail graded tests? Now this all depends on, you know, we have given, generally you'll find some different exercises, we are giving different attempts, right? So you'll have to see what how many attempts are available. So the attempts can be checked, right? So if you go to any graded quiz, you'll find that there are so we are just, so are you displaying this?
No,
yeah,
yet.
can you
yeah, sure.
Yeah, so we'll just share the screen. Okay, so attempts are visible. Okay, can everybody see the screen now?
No.
So you can see zero of one attempt, right? So that means you have one attempt here. Why there is one attempt? Because, you know, if I suppose I give you two attempts here, what, or four attempts, what is going to happen? So I can choose any one of them, right? So I will pass through, right? So if I give two attempts, what happens, right? Chances of, you know, is faster. Certain questions you will find two attempts, right? So I cannot show you here, but so certain questions based on complexity you will find there are different. See, here there are zero of two attempts, so there's a reason for doing that, right? Every question will differ. In what time limit we have to finish this course? Okay, so the last date is, I think, November 15, right, Kalpana? Yeah, November 15, I've forgotten. So, okay, so that is, so you have, so all the graded quizzes, graded quizzes are the one which will count towards the grades, right? Not other practice ones. But the practice is important. If you do not do the practice ones, you will not be able to answer the graded one. So we have a deadline, which is the end of the course. So all graded, you know, you can answer, but it becomes important that you complete little by little, rather than keeping everything towards the end. And it will be actually boring to do everything on one day, right? I mean, so you'll get fed up. So why you should do that? So a lot of, you know, other things, I mean, you should pick up little by little, and then, you know, you can proceed. What course content will be available after yes. course ends? Yeah, I think this is already answered. So you will still have the course content even after the course ends. I registered for the course Programming Basic recently. I would like to complete all the five courses offered. Okay, good. But it is impractical to complete it in this cycle. Yeah, I understand. Yeah. I want to know whether any time extension would be allowed for new registration. If not, when these courses will be re-offered? These courses will be re-offered again. But if you have, you can still register now because the registrations are open, right? Yeah, so before, there is a registration end date. Before that, you should be able to register, right? So you cannot register after the course ends. So it is impossible. So you'll have to take up for the next course if you want to do it after the course ends, right? So the courses will be rolled again, right? Probably in January or Feb or something like that. Okay. Amol Yadav, I can't submit the answers to the assignment. When I press save or submit button, no action takes place. Are you here? We would like to know what is the problem, because majority of people are able to submit.
Amol, can you unmute yourself?
Yeah, he's there. So you can unmute and you can let us know what is the problem.
Yes. Can you hear me?
Yeah, sure. Yeah. Go ahead.
Yeah. Listen to the lecture, after that, when assignments are there, when I click the buttons, no action takes place any. Means there is no submission takes place.
So
don't know why.
So where you are clicking on the submit button?
Yes, yes.
Okay. So there is no action which takes place. Okay.
Yes,
so
yes.
Is there a problem with your browser, or can we see your screen? I will be very happy to try to solve this problem, because that will be harder for you.
Okay, just...
Yeah, can you share the screen? We can stop sharing the screen.
No, I've already stopped sharing.
Oh, okay, fine. Because we have not received, you know, this kind of issues.
Okay, just...
Okay. So by the time you set up, I'm going to answer the next question.
Yes, yes, no problem.
Yeah, okay. So I have completed BE in computer science in 2018. I want to ask, after completing all the five courses and with good amount of practice, will I be able to get into any big tech giant company? So this will all depend on how much you have, you know, understood and you know, your practice, you know. So it is not about completing even all the courses. I mean, it's not like that. So these are the fundamental courses which are essential. You can take what is important for you. I mean, you will be the best judge to, you know, to actually understand, okay, I need this. So when certain problems come, right, so they will not say I'm a for loop problem or, you know, so they will be certain specific things, right, related to that domain. So generally people who, nowadays nobody writes compilers. If you see, nobody writes compilers, nobody writes, something in their own domain. So they always look for some other domain. So every giant tech companies, you know, if they are working and if you want to get absorbed somewhere, right, so there will be always interdisciplinary things. So that means you have the programming skills, you are ready for it, you know, you say that, okay, I can tackle these problems, right? So problems would be in other areas. So that is very important. So you'll have to keep open up what other areas are there, you know. So that is that. So some kind of domain knowledge is important, right? So just completing courses, yeah, you can still get a job. I mean, we don't say that you will not get a job, but, you know, still have to learn. So every life is like this, you know, today also we are learning. Okay, so I did my graduation in 2001. I'm still learning, right? So I mean, you can keep on learning. I can't submit the, okay. So has he shared?
No.
Okay. When will I be eligible for a certificate and where I get it? Okay, so that is already answered. So types of operators, I would like to know what exactly, I just received a question, types of operators. Are you asking me what are the types of operators? I mean, so in case you are here, probably, I don't know your name here. So, okay, there are a couple of operators, types of operators. One is arithmetic and others conditional, right? So where in conditional, you always use Boolean operators, right? And then in arithmetic, it's a normal, you know, mathematical plus, minus, and all the stuff and the divisions. So, I mean, that's the basic understanding of what is an operator. Recursive function. Now, the very basic definition of a recursive function is you just call it again and again, right? So same, you call the same function, right? So what you have to consider very important, you should see that it terminates, right? Terminates. So you need to terminate, right? So you'll have to set certain conditions when you call the function recursively, right? So I know that some people find it difficult to understand, but once you understand a bit of, you know, how, you know, simple recursive functions, right, like, you know, writing GCDs and all that, you can just program and then work it out using pen and paper, then you'll understand what are recursive functions, right? So don't look for very complicated functions in the beginning. Try to find very small examples to understand what are recursive functions, right? In programming basics course, the topic 7 is a bit complicated. Oh.
Topic 7 is pointers.
Okay. Right. So pointers is complicated, and I don't think you are the only one complaining. There are thousands of people I have heard or listened to where they feel pointer is complicated. But the basic, that is why there is a topic, you know, it is complicated. So we are trying to solve that complications, right? So we're trying to explain, right? We are trying to show you all possible ways in which pointer can be manipulated, right? So once you understand that, then that, you know, all this complicated business will go. So iteration concepts, function, class-based concept, and array-based concepts. I think I will not answer this unless there is something specific, and if you want to ask me, I'll be okay with that. You can put it up on the chat. These are very generic. Yeah. So are you displaying Amol Yadav?
in some cases I getting the server problem, but one practice test is there. This, for example, PPS 02 is there, set second.
Can you share your screen, please?
You are screen yes. important yeah. here because yes. you are facing that because we are not facing here.
Right, just minute.
Yeah. In the course, I couldn't find the basic syntax related to C++ like Hello World, Introduction to C++. Okay, so that is where everybody in the world do it. But we actually left it and we said that, okay, we'll not introduce. But there is another way to look at it. If you see the first, so we are not introducing in this fashion, but if you see the Dumbo, right? So input, output, you know, for those people who are actually trying to learn something. So the syntax becomes complicated. Even include, hash include, you know, IO stream, you know, it's complicated, right? So what we have done is that very simple analogy. We have taken like a Dumbo is actually trying to, Dumbo in the sense not an intelligent, a computer is not an intelligent. You make it intelligent or still it is not even intelligent after that because the logic is done by you and it cannot think beyond that, right? So so here we have simple statements like input, output and things like that. I mean, but those are not actually C++ statements, but they are just general way to understand how to interact with the computer, right? So output means what, input means what. So output in this case corresponds to printf statements, cout statements, and input corresponds to cin statement. So that is what we have illustrated in the first topic. Is it necessary to do programming basics first before doing object-oriented programming? Well, so doing object-oriented programming, you are learning how you play with the objects, right? And what is inheritance? What is polymorphism? All of those stuff. But that doesn't teach you the basic constructs like for loop and other things, which are required. So the same constructs are there in object-oriented programming, right? I mean, so, but those constructs are required, right? So you need to understand the basics because they're not very difficult, right? And then you can move to object-oriented, or you can even move to object-oriented programming, but you should have a little bit of background of those constructs. So C++ is an extension to C. That's how it was born, right? So it's not a totally, I mean, so it's an extension, it's a wrapper, and that's how you get that object oriented kind of thing. So there are other just object oriented languages, but there also you'll find for loops and other things which are very important. I didn't understand in function used in array how to give return value. Okay, so you have used in array. I mean, I assume that you have an array as an argument, okay, which is nothing but using, you're going to read something is passed by, you know, that array. So it's mostly by reference. So you can change that, but that's not a good way to do it. So you always have another array for it, right? I mean, you can have one as an input array and one as an output array and give it as, put it in the argument. If you really want to compute, so it depends on what you want to compute. So you have an array and then I want to compute something else and get it back, right? So that means I don't want to mess up with my original array, right? Right? So something like that. Or I just want one value. For that, you know, I have a, int something or double some function name. So it is going to return, right? So otherwise there's nothing to return if you pass everything by reference, right? So, I mean, in the argument form. So it can return in that fashion. I didn't understand the concept of when we declare variable as global, then how to use same. Okay, so we don't encourage declaring anything as global, because once you declare something as global, then it can be changed by anything, right? Any program will be able to, you know, change, and then your behavior of your program will change. So that's not a good idea. So I would advise you not to use anything global. Could you please give a hint about the program for GPA2? I think GPA 2 is, so is it displayed?
Yeah, this one. Oh, no, I'm not sure. This.
Sorry. So we can show you the, if you see our programs are little bit different than what you generally see, because, you know, there's a lot of elaboration here. If you see, you know, lot of elaboration that you see, the problem definition, lot of picture which tells you something, right? So, I mean, what is the hint that you are looking at? Because in real life, you have to read a lot of things, right? So there is no shortcut, right? So you don't cannot say that I'm not going to read this and then I'm going to program, right? So you have to understand what it is. What is the,
so what exactly, is,
what
the
exactly is the problem? So understand the problem is the most
what
important.
Is, what is
if
problem?
If you have difficulty understanding the problem, right? The hint is not a solution, right? So if you have understanding in, if you have problems in understanding the problem, we would like to know whether it is not understandable. It's something that we have written. Okay, so that will be a good feedback for us, right? So if you are not able to understand, maybe there is something which is not understood. Okay, we can welcome that, right? So that is, so I mean, if you are, if you have something to say on that, maybe you are welcome. Can I get certificate if I secure overall 4% I get 0%
already answered.
Yeah, okay, already answered. I do not know the answer of first graded programming in my basic programming course. Actually, yeah, so you will have to, I think all the time I've been answering the questions, these questions, I think your answer should, your question should get answered in some form or the other, I believe. We require course related materials. So we have given you what is enough, right? So that you don't have to read hundreds of books and, you know, and then come up with something, right? So you can always do that. Once you know what is covered, you can actually, so Wikipedia is a good source. Go to Wikipedia, search, you know, today's age is like, you know, everything is changing. So you keep on searching, right? So you'll have to inculcate that kind of practice. Due to my lectures of masters, I'm now, so how many time, how much of time? 33
yeah,
minutes
almost
gone.
Half an hour
okay. Okay, so I am going to answer, there's only one question on object-oriented, right? I'll just see what is it. Due to my lectures of masters, I'm not able to watch the videos and practice on a regular basis. So is it fine that I continue watching the video as per my preference? Will it affect my marks grade? It will not affect because you have to, I mean, there is a deadline which is towards the end of the course. So you can little by little do it rather than doing it towards the end. I would advise in that fashion, and there's nothing to worry because it will not affect your, you know, the MOOCs is like you can answer any time, right? But there's a deadline, so there is a due date, right? So that will not affect any grade, right? Srivastav has posted. Okay, so he has a problem to understand what is a constructor here. Constructor is nothing but it constructs your object. Okay, so initializes, right? So here you are saying I is equal to zero, but where is I declared? I is a variable. Okay, so I is a variable and you are saying that it is zero already initialized within the object. See this. And you have I pass through that interface, right? And then you want to say I, right? I should be initialized as I, right? I mean, that is what you are saying. So that means you are constructing. The meaning of constructor is you are constructing an object. Full code.
You could unmute yourself and ask.
Yeah, you can unmute and you can ask.
Because you have finished answering the questions.
There are some others.
Hello.
Yes,
sir. So actually, it was a basically an output question of C++, wherein we have to find the output of whole program.
Mm-hmm.
And here the constructor was given, int means an argument was there, ii equals to zero. But mm-hmm. after colon, one more variable was there, int i, which was declared in private side section of class A, and then again the same argument was given, II. And no, then
I'm still not understanding. So this is the program you're saying, right?
Yes, sir. This is the program.
It's already modified. You have modified it again?
No, sir. I have not modified it.
Okay, not modified. Okay. So yes, then where is the problem? Can you tell me what is the problem here?
Sir,
you
I'm not able. What is the constructor?
What is the constructor? That's what I explained. So constructor is nothing but it initializes, right? So, okay. So let me take this. See, let's take this example. So here you have x and then you have xx, right?
Yes,
so
sir.
Xx is this one. So what yes, it sir. Says is that initialize this x with this value, right? Whatever is the value going to be here. In this case, it is zero already, right? So when you construct b, right, 10, when you pass 10, right, what is going to happen? B is an object of type b and you are passing 10. So xx will become 10 and this 10 will come here, right? So that means your x, this x, this is the way it is written. I mean, the way it is initialized. So this x, you know, is initialized to this this value, right? This value. Are you getting?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. So
this is basically initializing any variable.
That's why it's called a constructor, right?
Okay, sir.
And there is another one called destructor. So you want to destroy the object, right?
Yes, sir. So, sir, we can initialize here also and inside the constructor body also.
Yes, you can do that. Yeah.
Okay, sir.
Okay. So, any other question? So what I would suggest is that take this program and start playing with it. That is, change that xx to something else, right? So you remove all these other objects, take only one class and just start calling from the main. You'll get more knowledge by doing that. You know, just changing, you know, little bit what you know already, right? So you have to build up on what you already know.
Yes, Bhaumik, you can unmute yourself. And can specify what exactly do you want to know in storage classes?
Hello, ma'am. I have brought in, ma'am, types of auto, static, extended, and registered types of storage class, ma'am. Can you define all and what is the difference between all of them?
I will not describe all of them here because they are well known. And so they are basically allocators, right? So they allocate certain amount, I mean certain size, you know. So one is register, one will be a which will get allocated in the register. So the size, so they are all depending on, you know, auto will have some other meaning. So those are actually required for writing platform specific code, right? So suppose you don't have platform specific code, then you don't need to use them. So if you probably go on Wikipedia, you will find a lot of things on it. Can we get full? So am I answering your question? So you will find such allocators mostly use storage, allocators mostly use in embedded systems, right? So where you actually need certain definitions.
Yeah, here's your plan.
Okay. Can we get full knowledge of after attending this course? Of course, I think so. Yeah, people should be able to. Working writing equal.
Yeah. So if there's anybody else who would like to ask a question, you could unmute yourself and ask, or you can type. Yes. How does the address return type, type and foo differ from the pointer return type?
Okay, let's make it a little bigger.
Hello, good afternoon, madam.
Yes. Hi.
Good afternoon, sir.
Right.
Hello.
Yes, please go ahead.
Sir, I downloaded the code blocks. Once I downloaded installed, on the first page it is showing new project, opening project, release versions, all these things. We need to click on the new project because code blocks I don't know. This compiler, Turbo C previously.
Codeboard is like it's little vast. It's little heavier than Turbo C. So okay. You need to click new project. There will be multiple screens thereafter. So I guess it's like creating something big sort of. So you're just not creating a file. Creating a project is actually a notion what you have in Codeboard. So you can actually click on new project. You will be asked to select a compiler, I believe. And after that, just follow the instructions on the screen, I guess, where to save the project, etc. Give a folder name. And okay. Then you can write the code, and then there would be a button, green color button, I believe. It would be or something. Compile.
Okay. So first we have to click on new project, and it will take you to... it will ask what is the compiler, madam, or...?
Yes, it would ask you for a compiler.
Okay.
It would detect automatically though.
Okay.
You can try it out and you can share your screen. Let us answer the question which is there on chat, or should we address this first?
We can address
this. Or you could share your screen if Codeboard is already, if you have already opened Codeboard.
Okay, madam. Can I share now?
Yes, please.
So, on this platform, I haven't shared your entire screen or window. I have to share
entire screen.
I have minimized the code blocks and kept it.
Yes, entire screen, and then start, then maximize code blocks.
Okay. Now you are able to see, madam.
No.
Just
a second. No, we still can't see your screen.
No.
So you may have to click on that particular window and
select
then select that window.
Okay, great. Here it is showing two options, your entire screen, window or Chrome tab. That's what he is asking for presentation.
So select that particular, the entire Google Chrome, I mean, the picture which is displayed on the left, and then say entire screen.
I didn't get you, madam.
Click entire screen.
Okay. You are visible again in that small window which appeared.
No, we are not displaying anything.
So,
professor, click on the present now, then you will get three options. Select the first one again, you will get another window. In that window, there is a thumbnail kind of image there. Click that, and under that, there is a share button.
Right. Thanks, Anjan, for elaborate answer.
You're welcome.
Nagesh, can I ask one question?
Yes, please.
Amul Yadav here. My question is, return 0 means it will return to main function. Return -1 means it will be the unexpected value.
Right.
What is meaning of the return 1 or return 2?
Okay, so they are specific things which are coming from POSIX standards. So portable operating system interface, something like that. So those standards were defined much later, before C++ or anything was, I mean, during that time. Stallman was the one who participated in defining the POSIX standards. So these things have remained, because whenever you say return zero, so the definition is the environment will feel that, oh, the program has successfully completed, right? So if you violate that, right? So suppose instead of zero, you put minus one, one or something like that, then that definition will become part of your environment. And so then the, you know, environment may say that program has not successfully, completed. I mean, there's no proper execution of this program. So these are
okay, minus one and one is the same or different then?
Sorry? They are different. It is the same
way. Return zero means directly it will go to the mains, means OS.
No. Zero means what? It is giving to the OS. OS is there. Your program is running inside the OS, right? It is telling the OS that program is successfully compiled and whatever executed or compiled, right? So, so that is
okay.
So, it's not compiled, but I would say successfully executed, because that's a runtime behavior of the program.
Yes.
So,
a difference in return zero and return one,
what
or return minus one.
Yeah. You still have a problem?
Yes. I can't hear your sound clearly.
Oh, can you not hear me now?
Yeah, I can now. I can hear.
Yeah. So, if you want to know more about it, then look at POSIX standards. POSIX. Okay. So, these are operating system standards.
Yes. Can you repeat this?
POSIX.
Okay.
POSIX. All capital.
Sir, excuse me, sir.
Yeah, right.
Sir, can you show that code block, sir? I am unable to present it.
We don't have code blocks here because we use the web version. We are used to Linux. Your machine is Windows, I think, right?
Windows 10, sir. I don't have Linux.
So, I mean, is it possible to put a Linux on it? I mean, you can always do a dual boot, Windows as well as Linux. Both of them will be there.
Yes, sir. But I am comfortable with Windows. It is user friendly.
I would say that I have not been using. I'm just my way to look at it. I don't know how it. But I have not used Windows for last maybe 23 years, and I am still happy. So everything you will get in Linux. So Windows is Windows. Every time you have to pay for something, you know, it's very difficult. Yeah. Okay.
Okay, Nagesh, I want to thankful to all of you. This is very fantastic course. I like this. Okay, I clear basic concepts lot of. Okay, thank you very much.
Right. Thank you so much. And can we go to that question? Yeah. There is one question. Can we show the screen?
Yeah. Sure.
Okay. Okay, there is a question in the chat. So it's something like this. So I just wrote a little bit extra thing so that you can understand. So here, this will be mostly int, main, and something like that. And you will have to always write return zero here, because keep this as a convention. Okay. So the return zero actually means here, now everything is done and then it has reached here, right? If it doesn't reach here, then you can actually return minus one. Right, so that is for the compiler. So that is for the operating system. Operating system has got its own data structure to identify how many programs are running. Are they successful? So all this information operating system keeps. So those meta information are required inside. So that is why this is the convention that we follow. So now I just try to answer this. When you say I have not completed this program, I just written phi, and then you have so what do I have to return here? When I say int star, right, what do I return? I mean, who is this person who asked this?
Joel Silva.
Yeah, Joel, can you come on, unmute and just let us interact.
Yes sir, I'm here.
So you asked me this question. I just constructed this. So here what is
yes.
int, so this is a reference. So that means anything that will be returned will be a reference value. Reference value means it is still an object, right? It is still an object.
Yes.
So here the what it is going to return is 5. That means when I go down and when I say int a, I want to initialize a, and then I can directly do this when it is a reference, right?
Okay.
I can directly access, right? But when I do this one, right, I need a pointer here, right? I need a pointer to be written, not a normal value, right? So here I will get a value, but here I need a pointer, and then I would have to dereference.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Right, star b is for dereferencing, right? And now when I say I want to return, so I have to return something, right? So what it is, int, I mean, I can still say a here because it is inside, I mean, right? And then I will say probably star of a is equal to 5, right? So what I'm saying here is, you know, I'm not doing a is equal to 5 because that's a pointer, right? Your pointers cannot be 4, 5, 6, they are given by the operating system, right? I mean, while execution.
Okay.
So you have to always do this, and then probably I have to return A. I'm returning A here. That is, I'm returning the whole pointer itself, right?
Okay.
And when I come here, right, so I get, pointer assigned, right, to B, right? So I can do this, and I can still do B is equal to, it's something like this. Right.
Okay. Yes, sir. So actually, my doubt is a little bit different. Okay, when we are returning by value, we are just returning a copy of a value, right?
Returning by value, yeah. Copy of a value, yeah.
So how does that differ from our return of reference?
So
address. I mean.
So reference, the same object is used, right? Same object. Whatever you are passing. You are saying that use that reference, I mean, that particular, area where that object is stored, modify and then give me back. That is the difference. When I say copy by value is actually I create another copy of the object, right? When I pass it, I will create another copy of the object. Then somebody will do something with that object. But when I return something, right, I mean, I will not be able to see the changed value. So that is by copy.
Okay.
Right. I mean, this concept can be very well illustrated. I think we have one example over there. That is, we are sending arguments by not exactly this question. Yeah. But we are sending arguments by, value based. And then we say we want to swap, right? We want to swap and it doesn't happen, right? When it comes in my program, I see that A and B is not just being swapped. I mean, so that means I need to do a reference of it. If I do a reference, it automatically gets swapped. I can also use a pointer to swap them, right?
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
So what you do is that you write program and see how all these things. I just wrote a little bit of just to illustrate. So you can write like this, right? I mean, you can just do a little bit of work, and so it is not difficult. You'll be able to understand. They are not very difficult things. Yeah. Okay. So do we have more questions?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So this is for
GPA 01. Okay, so we use in some program we use int, and some program we use long int. Okay, so what is the reason do you think it could be, and what does long int tell you? Right.
Pratiksha, can you unmute yourself? So she's telling that in the programming assignment they have not specified the size. How do you solve it?
Okay, so they have not specified the size. And so in some programs, we just use, I assume that in some programs that you are seeing, there is just int. In some programs, you are seeing that is long. Now you have to estimate whether it is the final value computed, right? So is going to, I mean, does it have, you know, the bit size? I mean, so typically your int is 32 bits, right? So 2 raised to 32 minus 1, that is what is the total value that your int can carry. Now, if it is a long, probably I believe it is 64 or something. So this depends on the machine architecture also. And so I am still trying to understand what exactly you are. So I have answered from my point of view, but then can you unmute, and maybe if I have not answered some portion of it, I would like to know. You can unmute and you can ask.
Pratiksha, are you there? This is
from another one. I notice an interesting behavior. Every time I compile and run my code, I see that the test cases are being changed each time. So for some test cases, the logical bugs in my code didn't got hit. Thereby, my grade is not getting reduced for that particular set of test cases. I feel this seems like a tweak, but not sure if this is an intended behavior. Anyways, thought of providing a small improvement.
Ashwin, we want that, if we are checking certain amount of test cases or certain amount of tests, so we, and there are, each test case has marks associated. So it's not that, like, say your program does not run for some complex test case, it should not be that you get a zero. So there are certain test cases which will pass irrespective whether there are some small bugs here and there, but like validations or, you know, something of that sort. Whereas they are randomly generated, so that, like, when you submit it, you exactly do not know what the test case was at that particular time, and like you cannot actually just hardcode that if test case is this, then my answer is this. So that's a different issue. Although, so we want that partial grading is also given. So certain test case will fail if we really want that a particular test case needs to be tested. So, and since it's a basic course, we are not that strict about all types of test cases, like negative, positive, going out of bounds. So, you know, we are not exactly checking everything. I hope I have answered this.
Can you give me the
what
steps?
Is the concepts of scope and lifetime? Can you elaborate on it?
I am still finding it difficult to understand. So what scope of what, and what lifetime? What is lifetime here?
Scope means the function of a
variable. If the variable is within the function, right? So the scope it remains within that. That scope means what is. So for example, what is my scope of getting into a Bollywood movie? Probably zero, right? So that means, so you understand. So scope is defined, right? So within that function. So I am now within that boundary, right? So that's a scope. Lifetime, I don't understand what is that you mean by lifetime here. So can you give me steps involved?
We'll get back on the forum.
Project in Yes, so yeah, you can do that. Are you sending assignment regarding to programming basic? I'll send them. I can't get that assignment. I would like to know what exactly you're not getting here. You can speak up. You can just unmute and start speaking. I mean, it is a very liberal kind of, you know, Google Meet.
Sir, excuse me, sir.
Yes, yes, yes.
Hello.
Yes, yes, sir.
Sir, I am Pranav. Sir, actually, after going into code blocks, it is showing so many tools, ARM tools, AVR, so many are there.
Do is we'll try to see whether we can give a small document or something. We'll post on the forum, say maybe end of the day or so.
Okay, madam.
That is a problem. We know that problem. The problem is when people see so many things, they get confused. That's very true. And when Eclipse and you know NetBeans had come in the market, so everybody moved towards Eclipse and NetBeans. If you see, same thing has happened here. CodeBlocks was intended to be as small as possible, you know, not having all those extra additional things, but they have actually added many other things and it has now become a mess. Yeah. So it has to be as simple as possible. In fact, we have a modified version of code blocks and which is as minimal as possible, wherein you will get to just run the program and things like that. So, but we are not using that.
Okay. So Mahindra would like to show the bulk registrations.
Yes, Mahindra, go ahead if you want to show the bulk registrations.
So, we are actually in code block project. Balamurugan, do you have a question? He's giving the stress. Yes, thanks a lot, Balamurugan.
Thank you so much.
So, with this, we conclude the session for programming basics and object-oriented programming. There would be you can still continue to remain here. We'll be addressing discussion. We'll be addressing queries of foundation of data structures, implementation of data structures, and algorithms course.
And if you towards the end of like at around 5 o'clock, if you want, we can give you one demo on the working project that we have. And that project is on simulations. And if you want, maybe you can contribute later on. So at 5 o'clock, we'll meet for a demo. If at all you want to, look for what interesting work is happening.
Hey, Nagesh, thank you so much. May I request Firuza if she can stop her presentation?
Yes.
How much time you will need?
Only 5 minutes?
5 minutes, okay.
In fact, 2 minutes.
Yeah, yeah.
More than that. Hello everyone, my name is Mahendra Parmar and I'm here to talk about this registration related queries. In fact, we are getting many queries about the bulk registrations from the institutes. So we thought of convey this message to you all also, so that in case you're a faculty or a student, you can talk to your administrative in charge and let us know if your institute is interested for bulk registration. Of course, there are added features like you get that registration at the discounted rate. And apart from this, as a faculty, you will be given a chance to see the performance of your student. And in the Google form, no, actually, while we were collecting the queries from the participants, I think Ashwin Khanna, he had a query about the double payment. So we discourage participants when they make any payment, they should not repeat it if the amount is already debited. So for him, we have already conveyed the message to the accounts team. So our accounts, I had a word with them. I was told that this refund will be initiated after the reconciliation. And hopefully by end of within next week or so, you should be able to get your refund. Okay, that's it from my end. And if you have any query related to bulk registration, please send us a mail on eOutreach. And in fact, my mobile number is also given, 9833594905. And there were also queries about the e-certificate, like Kalpana Madam has already said. We will be issuing it after the course end. Thank you so much, Firoza and Nagesh. Now you can continue. Thank you so much for your time.
Thanks, Mahindra. I was just browsing through code blocks, but never mind. I'll just start. Just give me a second. Yes. So we'll start off with the questions of foundations of data structures, which have already been asked using the Google form. So the first one is, how many hours should I give for studying online lecture videos? So would you like to answer? Yeah. So we have actually mentioned that you would need around 6 to 8 hours per week, but it would also depend on your understanding level, on your foundation, or on your clear thinking about programming and, you know, all such stuff. So maybe if you don't understand certain programming concepts, then this might be, you might need to increase the number of hours. So, but generally on an average, around 6 to 8 hours per week should be enough.
Which books to refer to know more about data structures? Okay, so if you actually want to have a very good reference, so I think even for programming today, I will answer for all of them. So for programming, suppose you want to refer a very good book, okay, so the course material teaches you everything, but if you want something basic and which is also there in the course, then you have Kernighan and Ritchie by C programming. So all other books which you see in the market, I would not advise. So the very classic one is Kernighan and Ritchie. Use that.
You have also written a book.
That's not in the market anymore.
So then for object oriented programming, okay, there are many books, but if you want to really study object oriented programming, right, it's vast. Stostrup himself has written a book, the inventor of C++, and if you keep it in your library, it will be a reference for you to understand a lot of things there. Then for data structures, I would say Sartaj Sahani, a very good book. Okay, so if you get a hold of that book, that is a good book to keep. And so there are many ones available in market, but I would not advise any of them. I will answer for algorithms. For algorithms, there is a classic book and which is still used widely, which we call CLR. Okay, Corman, Rivest, and another third author. So that is Algorithms by CLR. It's a very famous book. Use that book and it takes a bit of time to understand, right? So those books go in detail. Right. Okay, so now let's go to notes are just the words from video lectures. Yeah, I think we have given very concise. So those are not notes. What you see is a transcript. Transcript is the meaning of transcript is as is. No, it cannot be changed. Right. So if you have difficulty in understanding the video, then you see the transcript. That's the reason for that. Now, all our notes that you see, they are all in the, you know, if you see our practice problems or graded problems, so those are the notes actually. Notes means problems. I mean, and then the videos tell you how to solve certain, concepts, right? So then you apply those rather than giving you notes of everything. It's a daunting task, right? So I will try to defend in this way. You need to practice, right? That means you need to write something, you know, you need to change, you know, those actually become your notes actually. You have to make your notes, right? I mean, generally we generally do not have one particular book or, you know, a set of notes. There's nothing like that, you know. I mean, it's all, so Wikipedia, the huge collection on Wikipedia, those are the notes today, right? I mean, so why we need to create, you know, additional set of notes? But there are some notes, you will see that, you know, vectors, you know, if you go to object-oriented programming, you will find that they are all, I mean, they are given some basic things which are required. Otherwise, we would not advise, you know, defining what is an array and all that, you know. It becomes a little bit more verbose, right? So you don't need so much to read. You need little bit of something and then understanding it, right? So actually, I have joined a course, Foundation of Data Structures. It's too late and the device is faulty. So my course study got too late. I missed my exam. Do I get certificate? Yeah, you will get certificate only if you pass, right? It's not, if you paid and then you're not able to pass, you may not get a certificate. So you have to pass the course. I'm sorry that there's some problem in your device. There is no other way unless you have a minimal kind of a thing, right? So in this lockdown mode, I was without the mobile and I was not knowing what to do. So it's something like that. And two months passed and then I went and bought a mobile. So in this course, running batch wise, as I register for this course, I don't understand this. Batch wise is no batch wise. It's a self-paced course. You can take it at your own pace. Right, so there's no clearly hours defined for it, except for interaction like this, where we come and discuss. Somebody has written something with the quicksort. So, what exactly on quicksort you would like to know? So that is not very clear. Okay. So I believe you're talking maybe about partitioning of quicksort elements or something like that. The quicksort generally has got a random way of partitioning, and that is how you achieve something quicker, right? So if you compare with merge sort, the worst case and the average case analysis, you'll find there's a difference. Assignment completion platform code is not comfortable. Make assignment. I don't understand this question. In the GPA compiler, the main function is not visible. Okay, yeah, sure.
So somebody has written saying that the main function is not visible and the person is getting multiple definition of main function every time you run the code. So actually, if what we expect is that you just write the logic of the code in the function that we have given. Do not define main function anywhere, because at the back end, like, we do have a main function which is actually taking your code, compiling, running and actually producing some test result based on some random values which are given. So if you remove your main program, just do what is explicitly stated in the problem statement on IIT Bombay X. So like, say if you, I'll just give you a simple example. Say that you want to add two numbers and return the addition of two numbers. I'm just taking a very simple example. And let's say that you have to return the answer of two numbers, that is addition of two numbers in a variable called result. So if this is a problem statement defined, given, then do exactly the same way. You can define your variables, you can write logic the way you like, but in the end your final statement should be result. result is equal to some value which you have computed, and that would be the final output, that final result that return. We will be looking for, and that is nothing but return. So since you are in foundation of data structures course, I believe you would be understanding functions very well, return values very well. So please avoid writing main function. I hope I have answered this query. So this was also put up on the discussion forum. I'm not sure, sorry, whether it was for foundation of data structures or the other two course, but somebody had asked there and we had provided this kind of an explanation there as well.
Can you explain, can you tell us about arrays? What exactly you want to know? I from my way of looking at it, what you may want is understanding what is an array. Right, so array is nothing but a consecutive set of elements, right? So, and you access it using some index values. So a of 0 will be the first location. It always starts with 0. Okay, so a of 1, a of 2, up till a of n minus 1, that is what. And you define the array as a of some value, that is 5. That means I need 5 elements in that array, and they are all consecutive. Just to make your life easy, right? So you have I going from say 0 to 4 in case of 5 elements, right? And then you want to access each one of this individually. That is what the array is. Linked list. Now the reason for using linked list is that you want to, you know, you can very well use arrays, okay, so to do everything that you want to do, okay, but linked lists are the elements in the list are dynamically allocated, okay, and they are ordered in some fashion based on how you link them, okay. So that is what is a linked list, right? So I don't know whether you have more the question is linked list, so I don't know whether you want to understand in linked list in what fashion, or you know, something like that. So that means what would a linked list will have. So what is the metadata of that linked list? Like it will say that my linked list is having n elements, right? So and now I want to say this is the first element, this is the second element, this is the third element. That is the way you link it. And then I want to say that this is my last element. So that means that is always the null. That means there is no linking after that, right? So I'm talking about the meta information about the linked list. And then you want to say that my linked list starts here. That is a starting point. So it's always called as a front, right? The front pointer. And then you keep on going ahead. You can name it as you want, you know, not always front or anything, but just to understand, you know, front, back, you know, this kind of terminologies are used. How do we become expert in algorithm and data structure? Yes, to become expert, you have to learn a lot. I mean, not only just learn, I mean, just knowing things is not enough. So you will have to apply it, right? So, I think this is what we have been discussing, right? I mean, so I don't have any other answer than, you know, a lot of practice. If you practice is a must, and without which you cannot go ahead, right? It's exactly the same that the cricketers like Sachin Tendulkar, or you know, if they only knew what is a ball and a bat, they would have not been able to play the matches. But because they practice every day, right? So they understand where the ball is coming, how to hit the ball, right? And then what shots to avoid, right? I mean, so this is very similar to, you know, how you program. So what errors may come, what is that, you know, how are you going to, you know, identify all these things. It's very important. It's all on practice. Request to help you. So now this is on algorithms. To implement these algorithms, particularly graph algorithms in C language. I believe maybe your college needs some, maybe algorithms are taught in C. The reason why we are not using C, okay, that is, we are using C++ is because, right, it's because there is some abstraction that is possible, right? So if you write everything in C, then it is going to become very big code, right? So which code you should write in C++, which code you should write in C, that is a way to look at. when we say we are learning algorithms, we are learning algorithms, right? I mean, the sequence of steps required, right? If you go much lower and lower and start writing in assembly language programming, it's going to become very huge and you will not be able to understand what is happening where, right? So that will require a lot of attention to different structures that you are using. So we have chosen C++. We could have gone to any level, probably, Python and all that, but felt C++ was good enough for algorithms. Right? So that's the reason for using C++, right? You can write in C, you can write in assembly language also. I mean, machine representation, hex code, but I mean, it's going to be too much. But even then, if you write in C, the code is not going to be that big as assembly language, right? So, but here you would need some certain abstractions, and those abstractions are important. Yeah, OOP concepts and all those stuff, right? Please exploit the C platform for practice. Though you are asking the same question again and again. It is very difficult to implement in C. Oh my God. So why it is difficult in C++, I would like to know. What is the difficulty that you have, if you are there?
Suraj has asked a question.
Yeah.
You might want to address it.
Can we justify why, as if we start from 1, we can go till n, if it is... Okay, so these are all internal definitions. Now, why array started? I mean, this is a very old question. This is not a new question. Almost 30 years old. And you are not the only one asking this. So, reason for, if you have 0, okay, you can actually calculate the, you know, the if you have 2D arrays, 3D arrays, you know, you can actually calculate different, indexes in no time. Your code becomes very compact, right? In Fortran or other languages, I believe not in Fortran, some other languages, COBOL probably, yeah, where they're represented as 1, starting with 1, but then 0 turns out to be the best way to represent. I mean, you can write an equation to get a value at that point. I mean, I leave that answer to you. If from 1, then you'll have to do a little bit of mathematics. I mean, I'm sure that you'll be able to understand by just doing mathematical, how to access the fifth element of second dimension or something like that. So when I say 5 and 2, how do you use that, right, in a mathematical expression? If you can write and see the difference, that 1 and 0, you may even find it this on Stack Overflow, illustrating some example to it. I think I answered your question. Yeah. What is n cross 9 very difficult? I am not understanding
n by
what
n
is.
Balamurugan, you can unmute and ask.
Yeah, you can be free and ask.
That is because of starting from 0 or 1.
It is always 0 in C, C++.
Yeah, given that if it is starting from Fortran like 1,
suppose
if 10 numbers are there,
uh-huh.
So 10 minus 1 and only 9
values
will be coming.
No, it is, no, 0th one is also considered. 1, 2, that is the first value, 0th one, then the second value, third value, and the last value is n minus 1.
For example, if I put I equal to 0 and I is less than 10, then it is very easy, 0 to 9 will come.
Yes, it is 0
but
to for 10 elements.
9, but actually the number is 10. So that is what I just mentioned.
No, the number is not 10. Elements are 10. There are 10 elements and each one has an address. Address of the first element is 0. Address of the second element is 1, and
position.
Address,
position.
I mean,
address
I'm just
index.
Talking address because everybody, I mean, it's a position, it's an index. That is, I have you understood? I mean, what, or have you not understood this?
Counting is difficult, sir.
No, thousands and millions.
Numbers, 10 numbers, 1 to 10, it is easier.
No. But thousands.
If you say 0 to 9. Totally 10 numbers, 10 elements.
I you see your what question you say
is zero to something is easier, but it is not exactly here. But what you say is other languages, it is zero is easier. Because for example, if it is a 10, 20, 30, like that means zero, it is coming at 10, and 20, the zero at 20.
No, C++ uses zero. C++ uses zero, C++.
For a zero is easier than Fortran language.
No, that's not the answer, that zero is easier. There is a philosophical debate there. Why zero was included? Right, I mean, so there is a debate, and you have to go through that. So it's not about easy; it's about the way the mathematical counting is done. That gives you flexibility, right? So the particular equation that is internally written. Okay, so when an array is there internally, when you say fifth operation and I mean fifth index and all that, you know, whatever. So that calculation becomes easy. And so you cannot see that in C and C. You have to go at a machine level to understand this.
My another question is, we talk about array and vector.
Hmm.
Is there any specific difference between the array and vector, sir? Vector is the object or it is a...
Yes, vector is an object, means it is having some extra baggage, right? So now my vector I can define my vector as having any type. And that's also possible dynamically. Okay, so I will not speak about it. But then, so vector is a higher order representation of an array. Array is lower level. Array you are saying already defining, saying that this is my array, and all manipulation I will do now. Means I am going to insert value here. In vectors, what you do, you have already have an operation, right? So you don't have to write that operation, right? So all these are abstracted and created, like pushing you just put push element in the vector size will change, right? Array is not going to change. Array you'll have to resize. Now you'll have to delete that array, you have to create a new array. So there is a way to look at it. If you want to actually understand what is a vector, you can actually write in C to understand, okay, how to resize your array. You already defined array size as 5, right? Now I want to put more. So how do I resize? Okay, so you can actually create those interfaces as vector is giving you. But vector is giving you power to say that, you know, so that you don't have to fiddle with saying that increase my array size or anything. Vector, you're saying, okay, add, and it keeps a count, n.
So
whatever n number of elements.
No, my question is the array define array of a particular element. Same element, if I put a vector, whether the size of my program maybe increases or same, sir?
No, size of program is different. So even the number of statements.
For example, the float and double. The size of the float is different from double. Similarly, if I use the vector and the array, whether it has any difference in the size?
No, size of the array you are saying. Okay, yeah. Size of, suppose you have 10 elements. Okay, so now 10 elements means array is having 10 size 10, right? I mean, that's what you are saying. And yeah. Now you are having same vector of 10 elements of size integer,
yeah.
Right? So that is an array, actually an array. Vectors are represented as array internally. Okay, that is why they are fast.
Okay, sir. Okay. Yeah. Thank you. Sir. Thank you, Ernest.
Yeah, but yeah, correct.
Can you use some reference books on website that will help implement algorithms in C++?
I gave you a reference of CLR. If you happen to read that, that's the best book, right? Which has been used for last more than 20 years, I believe. Right. So that book is the best. I mean, I don't see any other, and there are so many coming in the market, but not all of them. So that book actually is very rigorous, and it takes you to a different level of thinking, right? So if you see our algorithm course, okay, so this is not a full-fledged algorithm course. Remember that. This is not about
here we don't cover everything of algorithms. So for to teach algorithms, you need another course, a very big course. So I think I might have answered. CLR is a Corman. You just type Corman, and on internet you should be able to Corman algorithms. That's the best book. Yeah.
Reduce the volume.
Okay. So anything coming up?
Pranav, I have just sent one link. You could refer that. It actually displays step-by-step instructions for creating a C++ program using CodeBoard. I guess this should help. I was looking for something like this only, actually.
Thank you.
Yes, thank you.
So, are there any more questions? Oh, can we run coding examples on phone? Yes, I think maybe possible. There are some ways to do that.
No,
I don't know. Yeah.
No, so I answered it.
Oh, okay.
So CodeBoard doesn't get displayed properly.
Yeah. So it is not compatible. Yeah. Okay.
Is so, there anybody else? You
is there
can
any
unmute?
Other answer? You can unmute and you can ask questions. Yeah.
Please feel free to do so.
We can wait for another 1 or 2 minutes. So any question is welcome.
I would also urge participants to write on the discussion forum. Just discuss anything that you would like. Say you want to improve a particular question, or say you want to have some more explanation. You know, any of these things you want to discuss on. The algorithm which is being taught, any such things, feel free to post. It's not necessary that if you have a problem only, then you would write on the forum. Is there any question? We have around 20 minutes actually.
Madam?
Yes, please.
The course is more of C or C++ course candidates. I have to start my course. I recently registered actually.
Which course is
this programming basics? It is more of C language or C++?
C. It is C++. Actually, we are using C in and C out. Okay, which is C++ thing. Rest everything actually is C.
Yes.
Only C in and C out. So what happens in printf and scanf? It is little bit complicated to write. Many students have this problem. In IIT also, we have first year students having this problem. So that is the reason we introduce C out and C in. And rest everything you will find it is mostly C. Okay. And when it comes to object oriented programming, we are actually using C++. C++ means object oriented.
Okay.
Yeah.
And these practice questions which are given, if you skip those questions also, doesn't matter.
The reason for having practice is, as I said, Sachin Tendulkar practices every day.
Yeah.
So that is the reason. So otherwise it is not required. If you already know enough, then you can directly jump to some level. Yeah, that is also possible. So. It's not that you have to go through the whole course, but if you feel that you are uncomfortable somewhere, then you should have that practice, right? So there is a lot of liberty here. So, and it doesn't count, practice doesn't count to your final grades.
So November, after November 15th, everything will be disabled. Even though you do assignments and all, it will not be counted. By November 15th, you have to complete.
So yeah, due dates will get over. That means you will not be able to submit after that particular period, after that particular date. But then the course will remain with you. That is, you will be able to access after. Okay, so does anybody have questions? More questions? Okay, I think I will take this opportunity to demo something which may be useful for anybody here, or if you can spread up some word regarding this, will be very useful. So I'll just try to share my screen. Okay. So this is what we have achieved during lockdown. I mean, so we got some second year and third year students, and you know, and then they have built something like this. Though this is not C++, okay, but then all the concepts remain same. They are not different, right? So you have, you know, you can drag and drop and things like that. So if you do programming, right, so you will be able to achieve this level, right? So only thing is that you need to learn a little bit more. I always say, you know, you just need C++, and see, it is not a language. It is about the concepts which are very important, right? How do I initialize? How do I control my iterations? You know, all of this is here, right? I mean, finally, you know, everything goes actually in a product, right? So that is the most important. So it doesn't matter whether it's C, C++, but the concepts, all of those remain the same, right? So this is an Arduino simulator. Yeah, okay, I'll go back, no problem. Is it necessary? You have to, I think I've been telling you that you have to practice. So that is why it is necessary. So otherwise, how are you going to learn? Okay, so I believe that you can learn algorithm without practicing. That is also possible. But you know, you just learn algorithms. I mean, so if there is no implementation, right? So how will you get a feel of it? Right, so that is very important. You understand to the fullest, right? So that is what I think you should look for, and then only you will be able to build something like this. You know, something like this. I mean, this work was done in 2 months time period, right? I mean, you can see. I will also show you C here. Actually, this is C. Can you see that it is C? I mean, do you think that this is something different than C? This is C actually. Okay, the way the C is written, but only thing what is written here is a loop is written and setup is written, right? And this is also C. You know, the way it is written, everything is C, right? Int I is equal to 0, I is less than, right? I mean, so here what it is doing is that it is taking this as a behavior, right? What you are specifying here is actually going on this board, right? At this board, there is a simulator here, there is a simulator here, okay, and then this one is actually compiled, like the way you compile your program. We can also compile it at the back end, convert it into hex code, the machine code. This hex code actually is a representation of what happens to this. I mean, what this board supposed to do, right? Now this board is supposed to say, I want to put 1, 1, 1 somewhere, and based on what is defined here, right? So I should get a 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So it's a counter, right? So I want to make this count something. So that's the whole code actually here, if you see. So I'll just show the running part of it, and then you will understand what is happening. So finally, you see, you know, C is used everywhere, right? So you see how it is counting, right? Suppose I change something there, it has to change, right? Suppose I say everywhere 0, I'll put everywhere 0. So I put everywhere 0 now. What happens? This is my program. Right, so I'm just putting zeros in first row and the second row. So what is going to happen? So it's not going to display 0 and 1. So it's going to display 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. That's how. So you see, everything is programming here, right? I mean, you can apply anywhere, right? So you still see C code. It's not that you don't see C code, right? So what amazing things you can do. I'll show you. We have a gallery. I'll show you a buzzer. So let's see buzzer. So first thing that you saw was, so this is also C code. You see? C code, right? And then you say, okay, let me simulate. What is going to happen? So it's beeping. I mean, maybe you are able to hear. It's beeping, right? So it's beeping. So here we demonstrate sound using C, right? I mean, we are demonstrating sound. I go to another example. Let me go. Okay. I also have a code here, right? It's also C. And then what is this happening? I mean, it's moving, motion. So we are demonstrating motion here, right? And then we have, amazing things you can do. You know, if you actually learn programming, I mean, this is what is possible. See, I have some values coming here. Moment I get things closer, values will change, right? So it's a guess sensor. The values are changing, right? I think this is the maximum value, right? So if I take it here, get a different value, right? If I take it far away, I will get zero. Okay, so there is some calibration and things like that. So you see, you're able to detect smoke and things like that, right? So this is one project, and there was another project. This was done by 4 students, and this was done by 2 students, okay, for a period of 2 months. And then this one, okay, so this is my circuit, right? And I want to do some electronics. So everything is programming here. So there is no, you can very well see that there is some programming that is happening, right? I would like to run this circuit. Okay, I have some way to control this circuit, right? So, and then which is internally taken in the programming constructs, right? So it knows what is the start point, what is my step, right? So how much, so this is my x-axis, and this is, I want to simulate this circuit in such a way that by giving some value, all right, values are already given, by the way, here. If you see, voltage is 5 volts, okay, I have another voltage which is AC, okay, and then it is sinusoidal, okay, it's written like this, it is interpreted internally in a different way, but this is how it is written here by the user. And then I have a transistor model. If I just you see that this model transistor, particular behavior of the transistor you'll get here. Otherwise you'll have an ideal way of representation. And then I want to step, say, 10 micro, okay, step time. And then based on, for that voltage, I want a graph, right? I mean, something like that. And then 10 milli. So I will try to simulate. I think we have some problem. Oh, there is an internet problem, I think. There is some internet problem.
Yeah, it was a
same. Okay. I think there's some network issue. Yeah. So, am I audible?
Yes, you are audible.
Oh, I don't know how I have internet some problem here. I'm using another tablet, so maybe that is the one which is. Okay.
Not sure what has happened.
Enter site is down.
Yeah, there is some problem. Okay, fine. Okay, so in programming, you will have bugs, right? I was not able to show you the final thing. But you know, in programming, always you will have bugs. So even Google or even Zoom crashed, right? Last moment, I mean, where people could not do anything. So bugs are always there, right? So yours, but you know, you the reason why you program, why you need to know programming is to understand what are these bugs and how do you come out of those bugs, right? That is the most important. And this fundamental understanding is very important. How do you resolve it? How do you come to a very clean code? Okay, it's the most important thing. And once you understand these fundamentals, probably, you know, you become better programmer, and then you know what to avoid, right? That is the most important thing. Yeah, I think I'm able to do that. So all this, you know, display, it's all programming, right? Without which you cannot achieve all these things, right? And then I want to maybe solve it. I have zero stop time as 10 milliseconds. I have time step as micro. And then maybe I will try to simulate. I should get some output. Yes, this is the output I get because that graph, that particular. So if you see, we are using graph, you know, this graph is different. I will show you very interesting node voltage, which is for this circuit and which is this one. This is what is the output that you get. This is an amplified voltage. If I close this, actually this circuit is represented as a graph. You know, what we are learning today about graphs and, you know, how they are connected. So here the representation is, these components which are there, you know, they are actually edges and not nodes, right? So I told you the problems, you know, in different areas, you know, what you have to do. Okay, this is my problem. I have to simulate. I have to apply now. What is an edge? What is a node, right? So these understanding comes if you actually do this, graph algorithms and things like that. Right, and if I want to show you how the graph is represented, in this case the graph is like this. Just have a look. So R1, right? This is a resistor 1 connected to this node and connected to this node, and the value is 10k. Okay, so just giving this example because R1 is here and I am getting these values here, but where it is connected, right? This software which is written understands and puts those values here, right? This is not written by us, this is generated, right? So for certain things you would have to generate, you know, this is actually a graph. I mean, at least the first one I will not consider. This is a graph. So there are various ways of representing graph. We represent it in this fashion. You can then internally it will be represented as an arrays and I mean that matrix adjacency list, or you know, you can have adjacency matrix and all that stuff, right? So you understand what is that I'm trying to tell you. Yeah, so everywhere there is a graph, everywhere there is a loops, you know, this is nothing but a loop actually. This is controlling, right? This is the control statements, I mean control values, you know, time. So that's my time, and then I have to get certain values here outside, right, at this point. So, I mean, programming is so important today. I mean, you can do whole bunch of interesting things. Only thing is that your fundamentals have to be very strong. And then you can move on to anything else. Yeah. So, if you have more questions on anything, algorithms, programming basics, I will be able to, answer. I can still extend it to another 15 minutes if you want, right? Or you can speak about your experiences, about this course, how are you feeling it, what is that you want to do, right? I mean, that's also very important. I mean, very important for you, right? So after this course, what do you want to do, or do you want some other courses we can think of? I mean, I'm free to discuss with us. You can just unmute yourself and start, speaking. This is a kind of a virtual meetup, right? I mean, we wanted to see something very close to how would we meet together and, you know, discuss things, right? So today, we have a luxury. I mean, you can unmute and you can, we are just friends here, right?
Sir, I am Balamurugan again, sir.
Yes.
Regarding the algorithm, I am using it as a course.
Yes.
In our programming, we used Bellman's dynamic programming for optimization.
Right.
Therefore, there will be some set of stage as well as state variable so that we can link one to another.
Mm.
We link as a chain. To get the optimum route for a particular one.
Right.
I am attending the graph algorithm with Bellman's also, along with other important things. Here, among that, in optimization, that is the best route, that is shortest route path, one is giving with the direction. Another one is without making the direction of one node to another node, which is represented by 0, 1 and minus 1 in the node graph table as the input.
Right.
So what is that significant if I use only half matrix form, that is upper half only without storing the lower half? Can you able to elaborate on this, sir?
No, see, all these algorithms, they have a specific way of doing things, right? So that is why it's a name Bellman form, right? So who discovered that algorithm? Who wrote that algorithm? Bellman, right? So it is in his name. So there are various algorithms. I mean, you can use, only practice will tell you what, why it is used, right? I mean, so there's nothing you can do that even without Bellman, right? So I mean, you can write your own algorithms also. But we are introducing the ones which are actually famous algorithms. The way it is, right? So that's nothing. So generally, that's why I said this course is actually a little on algorithms. Actually, if you see, it's more on data structures and because algorithms is actually huge to cover. And generally, you don't cover algorithms in this fashion. You actually come up with an algorithm and then you compare with the other algorithms, right? So if I want to discuss algorithms, then it may go to even 4 hours just to discuss why that algorithm. So these are called analysis. So you need to do analysis. You need to find out. So this that requires another course.
Yes, sir. What you say is correct, sir. Because in algorithm, we are trying to evolve many things like genetic algorithm or SWAM algorithm bad algorithm. Like that, the new ideas come into picture. We are implementing into the model so that what will be the best way to get the opportunity for minimum time required to run the model and at the same time getting the very closer answer. So that
right.
is what we are trying to develop the algorithm.
Right.
But many people are telling the different name and algorithm. Because I know Bellman's easier than the other people's.
Some things which are easier are not very efficient. I mean,
yes,
it is always like that. Right. So, there are algorithms where the algorithm would be very big, actually. Right, but then they do lot of node visiting and all that stuff, and it is probably very efficient algorithm, but the program will look big, right? So when the algorithm is very efficient, you will find such things, you know. If the algorithm is very short, you will actually see that there's very little workout that has happened, right? Those are very naive algorithms, and then the specialist ones exist, right?
And this all depends on what is the problem. So finally, your problem domain becomes very important. Where are you applying it, right? I mean, how are you trying to look at from what point, right? So if Zomato is doing it, Zomato is trying, or you know, Swiggy, or you know, all this, who is that? Amazon is trying to, or even Google, you know, giving a link and telling you, okay, shortest path, you know, there's a crowd here and this and that. They are not these algorithms, right, that you see. Why? Because they have specialized it. But then they have not directly jumped to that specialization. They have actually understood other algorithms. So that means this becomes your base. Once the base is ready, then you can think of, you know, doing a lot of analysis. And that is how algorithms are born. So that so if you have just one algorithm, I don't think, you know, you can apply it at 100 places. So you have to find the problem. The problem becomes very important here.
I think, thank you, sir. Thank you very much for your kind information, sir. Thank you.
Right, right. So I think maybe people have joined for the demo, I believe, and I have completed the demo. So I can still give my demo again. Sir, will this kind of session organize in future before? Yes, we are trying to organize every month so that this could be helpful for everybody, right?
I'll formally thank everybody. So then maybe you can have the demo.
Yes.
Thank you, Firoza and Nagesh, for patiently answering all the queries. So
we can go for another 1 hour also.
Okay. So maybe next time. Thank you all participants for joining the session. So we will have, as Nagesh and Firoza said, we will have such sessions every month, and you will be notified on your email and on the course. And if you have any other feedback also, as Nagesh and Firoza said, please feel free to write to us. You can post it on the discussion forum. So please make use of the discussion forum, which is very important for you, your learning. And it will also help us with our course. So if you have any suggestions or queries, please make use of the discussion forum. And as I said in the beginning, so everybody will get a e-certificate once you clear all the requirements for the course. So the course requirement is given in the grading policy. So please read those grading policy, and please attempt all the quizzes. And since this is a self-paced course, you can take the course at your own pace. And the course is open till November 15th, but you have to attempt all the quizzes before November 15th. After November 15th, the course will be archived and it will be available on your dashboard, but you will not be able to attempt any of the quizzes. So please finish all your quizzes before November 15th. So November 15th is the hard deadline. So we will not be able to extend the course further. So please attempt all the quizzes before that. So thank you all for joining, and whoever wants to stay back for the demo, please do. Thank you.